say good morning.
Good morning.
We've been having a few technical difficulties, but we're going to go ahead and praise the Lord this morning. Amen?
Amen.
This is another day set aside for celebration of freedom and independence. 13 colonists came over in 1776 from Great Britain. And so tomorrow we celebrate the 4th of July. Amen?
Amen.
So we want to really understand why it's important. I know people have a problem with why do we celebrate the 4th of July? Because of the freedom of religion, the freedom to come up and worship. We have the freedom. We don't have soldiers standing around us with guns keeping us from worshiping. We can come freely to the house of worship. Amen?
Amen.
Now, most of you that don't know the Bible, I want to teach you the Bible today, but the United States is not in the Bible. You say, what, preacher? No, the United States became Great Britain and all these other countries. We'll look at, again, Europe and Egypt and all these countries and Greece and Lebanon and Jerusalem and Iran. All these countries are in the Bible, but the United States is not in the Bible. But it does talk about all nations will come against Israel in the last day. So there's a possibility that we will also defect against Israel. But let's pray that we will be an ally to Israel. Amen? A little weak on me. Amen?
Amen?
So I want you to take your Bibles. I'm going to run through a few verses, then we're going to get into the Bible today. Take your Bible and turn to the first book, Genesis chapter 2. And when you get there, say amen. I want you to keep your Bible open because we're going to have to walk through a few verses in the Bible. Genesis chapter 2. Did that say amen?
Amen.
We're going to go down to verse 13. This is again in the Garden of Eden, where Adam and Eve, when God created the world, it says, verse 13, and the name of the second river is Gihon, the same as that that compassed the whole land of what?
Ethiopia.
So Ethiopia is in the Bible. Where's Ethiopia? In Africa. Now, we're not sure where the Garden of Eden was, but we do know out of this land that Adam and Eve was on, they had a river that went through Ethiopia. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Turn over to Psalms 68. Now, Psalms is in the middle of the Bible. I want you to follow me in the Bible as we study the Bible. Now, I'm a Bible teacher. I tell you all the time, it's not my opinion, not my philosophy, not my politics, but what thus saith the Lord. I believe in the inspired, inerrant, infallible word of God. I use the King James 1611. I believe it's the closest translation from the Hebrew, the Greek, the Aramaic, to the English version because it was transferred from the text receptacle. So that's what I believe in, the word of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Psalm 68. Are you there?
Amen.
Let's jump down to verse 31. It says, read that 1, 2, 3. Princess shall come out of Egypt. Ethiopia shall soon stretch out her hand to God. So what it's saying is that Ethiopia and Egypt, but it's saying Ethiopia apparently is not trusting God. So it says soon, one day, it goes stretch out their hand to God. And I'm here to tell you, we got missionaries that are going to Africa, going to Kenya, going to all these countries in Africa. And right now, it's still called a dark continent because there's a lot of Buddhism. There's a lot of a witch doctor and a lot of things going on. But one day, they're going to stretch out their hand to God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Turn over to Acts chapter 2. Now, again, when you get in the New Testament, you'll find out you got the gospel. Then you go into the history of the church in Acts chapter 2. And you get that, say amen.
Amen.
Now, this is not my text. This is just my backdrop to get you ready for the word of God. Acts chapter 2, are you there?
Amen.
I heard one amen. Are you there?
Amen. Amen.
Verse 10. Mm-hmm. Phrygia and Pamphylia in where?
Egypt.
And in the parts of Libya. So Libya's in the Bible. And Cyrene's in Africa. And strangers of Rome. Rome is in the Bible. Jews. Everybody say, well, where did Jews come from? They're in the Bible. You see the word Jews and proselytes. What is a proselyte? A proselyte is somebody who has taken the Jewish religion. They were not a born Jew, a biological Jew, but they have accepted the Jewish religion. You with me?
Yeah.
Verse 11. because they're away from God, neither the Jews, but the Arabs are there. We do hear them speak in our tongues the wonderful what?
Works
of God. So we see all these nations are there in the Word of God. But I want to tell you again, the United States is not there. But when you get in study history, we're talking about, if you don't study history, it repeats itself. There were four major kingdoms in the Bible. It's in the book of Daniel. I don't have time to go there. There was Babylon, the first kingdom. There was Medes, Persia, who came in. And then there was Greece. Greece is where we hear about Alexander the Great. You study history. And then there's Rome. That's the Roman Empire with the seven hills. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
So, Phil, you know about history. So I want you to know this is in the Bible. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We're studying the Word of God. Now, the Bible uses a lot of allegory, symbolism. The Bible sometimes uses animals as symbols of nations. Again, they use the lion, the bear, the leopard. When you start studying these nations, you'll find out that certain nations have a bear symbol. The United States is the bald eagle. It's an animal, a high bird that preys on the small, but it's the eagle. Then you have Canada, which is the beaver. You have Australia, which is the kangaroo. You have India, which is the tiger, the Bengal tiger. And these are animals that are found in those countries. You have China, which is a dragon. These are big, and also a panda bear. So these are types that represent. And then the Bahamas, you have the flamingo. And you have, again, in Britain, the lion, and Russia, the bear. So these are countries, and these are symbols. And some of these symbols are represented in the Bible. When you talk about, again, the goat in the Bible, it's talking about Grecia. When you talk about the ram in the Bible, it's talking about Persia. So I want to tell you that, yes, countries are in the Bible, but not all countries are in there because the United States is not there. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
But I want to preach to you today from the book of Psalms. Turn to Psalm chapter 33 and Proverbs chapter 14. And you need to get a Bible because I'm a Bible believer. We need to study the Word of God. Psalm chapter 33, Psalm of David. Well, it don't say David wrote Psalm 33, but we'll do Psalm 33 and then Proverbs 14. When you get to Psalms 33, say amen.
Amen.
Y'all know how we do. I'm a Bible believer. I read one verse, you read the second verse till we get to the end, then we'll turn to Proverbs 14. Psalm 33, verse 12. I give you my title. Then we'll pray, and then we'll get into the Word of God. Psalm 33, verse 12 says, blessed is the what?
Nation.
Now we're talking about America, and it ought to be America, but this is any nation, whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he has chosen for his own inheritance. From the place of his habitation, he looks upon all the inhabitants of the earth. There's no king saved by the multitude of an host. A mighty man is not delivered by much strength. 17. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them. This is what we're going to be talking about today. If you want to be a country that's eye on the Lord, you need to pray that fear him upon them that hope in his mercy. Verse 19.
To deliver their souls from death and to keep them alive in famine.
Our soul waited for the Lord. He is our what?
Help
and our shield. Verse 21. Let thy mercy, O Lord, be upon us according as we hold it in thee. Back what I said in verse 12, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Turn to Proverbs 14. We'll read verse 34 together, and then I give you my title, and we'll pray and get into the Word of God. Proverbs 14 in the middle of the Bible. Yes, amen.
Amen.
Verse 34, 1, 2, 3. Righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. When I get into the message today, we're going to talk about if you want to be exalted, you want to be lifted up, you need to God will not tolerate sin. God is too holy. He can't look on sin. So when the nation get into sin, they bring a reproach on the name of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
I want to talk to you for a little while about, it's one thing to say we believe in God. But it's another thing to live a godly life. You know, a lot of people say, I believe in God, but they don't live nothing. So we're not talking about just believing in God. We're talking about living a godly life. Amen? Put your bow your heads. Dear the Father, we do thank you for another Lord's Day. Thank you for the day before 246 years of the 4th of July, independent, that this country became independent, became a separate independent nation. Thank you for America, Lord. And with all this problem, Lord, it's still one of the greatest nations on the face of the earth, Lord. Military, political, technology, Lord. With all the problems, Lord, I would not want to be anywhere else but in America. I know a lot of people say to leave America because of politics, but the bottom line is that we get to doing what you call us to do, you would bless this country. Lord, we want to pray for this corona situation, Lord. While our piano player was out with corona, Lord, and we understand now that she's back home, so we lifted up Tyler and her new son, Lord. Thank you for sharing, and Father, being there, Lord, lifting up all the others that may be in the hospital, Lord. We always lift up the first line responders, Lord, the nurses, the doctors, the firemen, the policemen, Lord, the ambulance drivers, Lord, the techs, the technicians, Lord, the pharmaceutical, the people that are helping us navigate, Lord, the people at the service table, the people at the grocery store, Lord. We're praying, Lord, that you would work all this in here, Lord. There have been some variants that come out, Lord, that are still hitting people every now and then. Somebody get a case of. I heard from somebody today say it may be him forever, but we ought to be able to live with it. So, Lord, I'm praying that you would help us to flatten out the curve. Lifting up Jerry, he lost one of his relatives, Lord, just a couple of days ago. Lord, lifting up his family, Lord, praying that you intervene and you comfort them in that time of bereavement, Lord. Lifting up our schools, Lord. We know the children are out of school, Lord, so we pray, Lord, that you would give them some constructive to do during this time of the summer. Praying for our Vacation Bible School and our missionary conference that will be coming up, Lord. Praying that you would bring the youth out, Lord. There will be a time of refreshing, be a time of learning more about you, Lord. Thank you for our piano player, Lord, that we got today, Lord. Thank you for her coming, Lord, and being a blessing to us this morning, Lord. Just thank you, Lord. And we're so grateful for her being able to come, Lord. Praying again for our families, our children, our grandchildren, our relatives, our neighbors. Praying for every church planted by your right hand, Lord, praying that you would intervene. Now, Lord, I pray that you forgive me of my sin. Help me rightly divide the word of truth. Use me as a conduit, as a vehicle to preach the unadulterated word of God. And we'll be careful to give you all the honor and the praise. For in the name of Jesus, I pray. Let everyone say, amen.
Amen.
One thing besides believing in God, there's another thing to live a godly nation. When the stock market is crashing, when we're going through a recession or inflation, when the interest is creeping up, when the housing market is beginning to go down, when health care and Social Security is looking at being repealed, when factories are being sent overseas and outsourced, when the border wall is open with no background checks, people can come in whether they're criminals or not, and there's nobody checking. When God is taken out of American culture, God is taken out of our schools, taken out of our homes, what do you expect? Crisis. And I'm here to tell you, even though America is a great country, we're in a time of crisis. We need to return back to being a godly nation. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
James said it like this. He said, thou believest in God, thou doest well. The devil believe and tremble. Let me tell you, it's more than just saying I believe in God. I mean, the rappers have crosses on their neck. They have tattoos. I believe in God. The sports writers have all the entertainment. But let me tell you, it's more than just believing in God. It's living a godly life. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Not enough. Psalm 146:3 says, put not your trust in man.
Yes,
put not your trust in princes. Put not your trust in world leaders. Let me tell you, I pray for our president, but I don't put all my trust in the president. I put all my trust in the Almighty God, the Lord Jehovah, and also Jesus Christ. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
The world leader, United Nations, and all these countries. Let me tell you, Germany and Britain and China. Look, I don't put my trust in the Lord. Psalm 33 is our text. It says, blessed is the nation who God is the Lord. I'm here to tell you, we started out right, but we done got off track. I don't know, you hear about all these Amtrak jumping the track. You hear about all these trains getting off the track. Let me tell you, America started out right, but we done got off the track. And when you get off the track, you in for a wreck. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
If America want to be godly or want to be great, we need to put God back in our society. I know we're talking about making America great and positive, but that ain't it. You make America great with putting back in God in our lives. Amen, somebody. Every kingdom, when you study in the Bible, that fell from pride and self-righteousness, fell from moral decay. And we need to get back. History records most nations didn't live no more than 200 years. And America tomorrow is celebrating 246 years since 1776. We're 46 years over. But let me tell you, America, if they're not careful, is on the road of God destroying it.
Amen.
Y'all get a little weak on me.
Okay.
God will destroy a sinful nation.
That's right.
Amen, somebody.
Amen.
So we need to get back to doing what's right. Righteousness exalts a nation. What is righteousness, preacher? Doing right. Don't cheat. Don't lie. Don't steal. We can get off in the Ten Commandments, but you know what's right. You know what's wrong. I've heard people say, well, preacher, I don't know what's right and wrong. Yes, you do. You know when you're lying, you're wrong. You know when you're stealing. And we're living in a day now where wrong, everybody call evil good and good call evil, and it's been reversed. Let me tell you, wrong is still wrong. Cussing out somebody is still wrong. Profane language is still wrong. Gossip is still wrong. Let me tell you, you know what's right and you know what's wrong. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We need to get back. Righteousness. It's not wrong to want to be prosperous. It's not wrong to have a business flourishing. She said she wanted maybe go into business or whatever. It's not wrong to have a business, but it's wrong to leave God out. Amen,
amen.
Somebody.
Amen.
It's wrong to think God is going to bless you.
Amen.
This scripture is clear. If you want the blessings of God, you need to put them in the equation.
Amen.
The Bible says some water, it's talking about soul, but if you can use that some water and some soul, but God give increase. God give the increase in the left. We want our stock market to get back. We want our money to get back. We want our home to get back. We need to put God in.
Amen.
This ain't even my message, but we got so much shooting in schools now, it's pathetic. Every time you listen to somebody that took a gun to school, we need to put God back in school. Let me tell you, if we put God back in school, we wouldn't have guns in school. And we went back to praying in school. We wouldn't have bullying in school. We need to put God back in school. We need to put God back in the government. We need to put God back in the Supreme Court. We need to put God back in the White House. God needs to be first. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
3 points today as we talk about God. There's one thing to say, I believe in God. Another thing to live in. Point number one. America downfall. And I love America. I'm patriotic. I wear my red, white, and blue. I wore it yesterday. But if America downfall, if we have complacent and indifferent people toward God. It's just like we talked about in Sunday school. Haggai, they say, well, is it a time for me to be doing something for the Lord? Let me worry about myself. We need to stop being complacent when it comes to God. All that is necessary for evil to triumph is for good people to do nothing. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You mean you're not going to stand up against that? It's wrong. Well, you know, let the world go to hell. No, no, no. God called us to be salt and light in the world. Good men going to have to stand up and speak up. Good men going to have to be, I said before, this church, it's not just here to be isolated in the community that people pass by the church. No. The church is to be a light and the salt. We need to go around and tell the community that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. There's a heaven to gain and a hell to shine. We need to tell people to come to the house and come to know Jesus Christ and repent of their sins. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
take you out on the ship and went down in the bottom of the ship and went to sleep. Are y'all listening to me today? The problem with America is we got too many Christians sleeping when they should be speaking. The problem with America, we got too many Christians that got cold and callous. Should be standing up. We need to get back to doing what's right. And as I was studying this, I found there was a guy named Rip Van Winkle. Y'all know who Rip Van Winkle is? I know it's a fairy tale, but they say somebody gave him some liquor or drank some dwarfs, and they tricked him into taking that, and he drunk it and went to sleep for 20 years. And the world went right on. I'm telling you right now, we don't need to go to sleep. We don't need to be like Jonah. We don't need to be like Rip Van Winkle. We need to stand up and speak out and do that. Sin disgraces a country. Sin destroys the health of a nation. We need to get back. We need to be like Daniel. When Daniel went down into Babylon, Daniel went to eat the king's food. We need to be like Josiah. Josiah was 8 years old when he became the king, and he tore down the altars of Baal. We need to get back. Men and women need to get back to serving God. We need to get back to being faithful to the house of God. We need to get back to praying on our knees. We need to get back to getting together and raising a standard for the Lord. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
You know, it's not natural for men and women to do right. It's natural for us to live without God and do our own thing. It's natural for us to neglect his commandments and his statutes and his precepts. It's natural for us to draw away from God. We need to not, Jesus said, you say you love me with your lips, but your heart is far from me. Don't speak of something if you're not living. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
The nation needs to draw closer to God. You know what the Bible says in John 3:19? It said, men and women love darkness rather than light. Because their deeds are evil. Did you know that a lot of stuff going in the nighttime? Oh, you want to act like you know what I'm talking about. You know when they have nightclub at night? You know when they have a strobe light at night? You know when men sneak around with women at night? You know, there was a car one time parked in the neighborhood, and everybody was trying to figure out where it was, and he had been parked on two streets over so he could go and sneak around and be with a woman, and they had his car towed. Let me tell you, see it. At night, let me tell you, we need to get back to, everybody, did you know what the light does? The light reveals sin. Mm-hmm. Amen, somebody?
Amen.
Now, I'm not talking about anybody, but let me tell you what happened. At night, the roaches come out. And the rats come out. But you cut on the light, they scatter, right? When the sun come up, the birds begin to sing. The crow begin to crow. Let me tell you, we need to be light in this old wicked world. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We don't need to be like Jonah. I don't need to be like sleeping like Rip Van Winkle. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, I'm talking about Israel, but the application now, which are called by my name, you'll call yourself a Christian. All America's 65% Christian. I beg the difference. Call by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. Oh, let me preach a little bit. If America would turn back to God and humble themselves, and then it says, and turn from their wicked ways. A lot of people don't like to say that part. You can seek God's face, but you got to turn from your wicked ways. Then will I hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sins, and I will heal the land. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
We need to come back to America. Romans 1 talks about how America is filled with all unrighteousness and backbiting, haters of God, and despiteful and proud, and without natural affection. And we done gone and boastful. And it said that who knew the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do them, but have pleasure in doing them. They stubborn their nose up at God. Let me tell you, it's natural. I don't want to preach on nobody today, but it's natural for a boy to like a girl. It's natural for a parent to like your children. It's natural for you to love your family. But when we start doing unnatural things, we're getting away from God. And not only are we getting away from God, but we're boasting in it. Let me say, get back to doing what's right. Amen, somebody. For me to love my wife. It's natural for me to love my children. It's natural. It's a natural thing that we need to do. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
If we seek God, number one, we should seek him with all our heart. You know, some people want to seek God halfway. God don't want to meet you halfway. Seek God with your whole heart.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Well, you know, I go to church every now and then. God don't want you to come to church. You know what the Bible says in Revelation? God said, I'd rather you be hot or cold. But because you lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. God don't want you to be in between. You know, it's just like coffee. I don't like cold coffee. I like it hot. Hot and black. God said, I want you to hot. I water. Cold water. I don't like warm water. I don't like lukewarm water. So God is saying, either be hot or cold. Don't come in here lukewarm. Well, you know, I just show up every now and then. Well, every now and then I darken. No, God wants you to get back to serving him with your whole heart. And then it says, humble and prostrate yourself before God. Put yourself, you know what I'm saying? We need to weep, and we need to mourn, and we need to cry out to God. We need to ask God for his mercy. And that song is said, call on to God, and he will help. He will be your protector. We need to call on to God. And the first thing is that we need to be first to begin to pray and hold out. The first thing we need to do is take the first step. You ain't going to never do nothing if you don't take the first step. It's just like a car. You can't drive the car unless you get in the car and you cut on the gas and you put your feet on the pedal. You got to take the first step. God is not going to do it for you. Even when he fed the children in manna for 40 years, they had to go out and pick the manna up. God ain't going to send you food and then come in and spoon feed you. You need to do your part. So let me tell you, your first step is to take action. Step forward for God. Amen, somebody. Read your Bible. God ain't gonna put the Bible in your hand. You got to pick the Bible up. Amen, somebody. Get on your knees. Pray. God ain't gonna put you on your knees. You got to do it. So we need to take the first step. Not neutral. You need to move out for God. The solution is, I say it all the time. It's not in the White House. It's not in the government mansion. It's not in the courthouse. It's in your house and in God's house. And we want God to hear us. We need to put back God in our home. We need to put back God in our churches. We need to put back God in our community. We need to put back God in our school. It has nothing to do with politics. God is not going to orchestrate politics. We need to get up and stand up for the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Back to our text. It's one thing to say we believe in God, but another thing to live a God life. Point number one, America, downfall. It's complacency of God's people. Point number two, we must do these three P's. Pray, persuade, and participate in changing our nations. One soul at a time. We are a republic. A lot of people get that mixed up. We're not talking about Republicans, but they say we're a republic. That means that the public policy is shaped by American citizens. A republic means that the best, most efficient way to change the government is to change the moral standards and laws and get people back to God's word. We are a republic. People need to vote, but we need to vote what the Bible says. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Then we need to pray. 1 Timothy 2:1 says, pray without suffering and prayers and intercession be made, giving the thanks for all men, for kings and presidents, for all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in godliness and honesty. People have a problem with the military. People have a problem with policemen. People have a problem with badges. Let me tell you, God brought them and put them in order so that we can have a peaceful life.
Amen.
Pray for them.
Amen.
Where the police are crooked, pray for them. Where the military, pray for them. Pray for them. God told us to stand up and pray for our nation. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Now let me show you how Christian this nation is. I know people say, there's not a Christian here, but let me hit down. The president of the United States takes his oath of office with his right hand on the Bible. You ever seen it? When they swear on a president? They swear him in on a Christian Bible. Amen, somebody. The Congress, let me hit down. When they have a Congress, all the people in the Congress, they open up the session of the Congress with the chaplain in prayer. The Congress open up in prayer with a chaplain of the United States of America praying for Supreme Court, they have the Ten Commandments behind it. They have a picture of Moses with the scroll. When the Ten Commandments have a session, they said, God bless this United States Supreme Court from the Bible. Amen, somebody. We need to persuade people. Paul said, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade people. Now, I'm not talking about scaring people, but let me tell you, folks, if you never heard it before, there's a heaven where there's piece of gold, where they got pearly gates, where you won't have to thirst, where there's no more tears and no more sorrow. There's a heaven again. So let me encourage you. You ought to want to go to heaven. Amen, somebody. I don't know nobody that don't want to go to heaven. Amen. It's just like if I had two glasses of it. One of them had water in it, pure cold water. One of them had poison in it. And I asked you, which one would you take? The wise, common sense person would take the clean water. Amen, somebody. So we need to persuade people. Paul said, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. And we'll make manifest to God. They showed that Jesus failed in a lot of these countries. Now, I know we can't despicate who Jesus was and what he looked like. But we can tell people that he came, he died on a rolling cross, he shed his blood, he was buried 3 days, and he rose from it and went back to heaven to make a place for you and me. Amen, somebody. Amen. And then we need to participate. God ordained three institutions. He ordained the family, Adam and Eve. God told Adam to leave his mother and father and be cleaved to his wife. And they became one flesh. Amen?
Amen?
God believes in families. God also established a government. He said that again, whosoever shed man blood by him shall man blood be shed. That's why we believe in capital punishment. I know what you're saying, preacher. I can't serve on a jury. I couldn't put a person to death. I hate to tell you this, but I believe the Bible. I believe if somebody go out and kill innocent children and then try to plead that they, I believe in capital punishment. I believe in the death sentence because God said that that blood should pay for the blood of those kids. Amen, somebody. And then it says God established a church. Jesus said this, upon this rock, I build my church. And what? Gates of hell shall not prevail. I know what you said. You said when the church is falling, let me tell you, the gates of hell ain't gonna take the church down. That's gonna always be a remnant. It may not be a lot of folks going to heaven, but there's gonna be a few. The church will prevail. The church will never fail. The gates of hell, all the demons, all the imps, everybody, Satan's will not stop the church. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Shame on Christians who pledge their allegiance to a political party and not the word of God. Shame on Christians who won't go and vote to change this country. Shame on Christians who don't stand up for the Bible. Shame on Christians who won't pledge allegiance to the flag. Shame on Christians who won't do the taxes. Let me tell you, we need to get back to being true to God. We need to get back to supporting this country. Now again, I'm a patriotic and I love this country and I'm an Afro-American, but I'm here to tell you, I love Jesus above everything else, and he allowed me to be born in America, and America is still the freest country of America where I can practice my religion without fear or favor, and I can preach the unadulterated word of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
I ought to be thankful. I ought to be thankful for what God has done in our life. Now they're trying to talk about the American dollar. They got the Bitcoin out now, the euro now, all this stuff trying to change. And they talking about the number 666. Let me tell you, they can do all they want. I'm going to still trust in the Lord. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
This old flag, a lot of times y'all don't know, but those red in that flag has a picture of the blood that was shed for our freedom. I don't know what you know about it. We done been through Civil War. We done been to World War I, World War II. But we are grateful that God has allowed us to have the right. Matter of fact, the amendment number one is the right of religion. We have the right to come to this church and praise the Lord Jesus Christ because this nation started out as a nation founded on the principle of the word of God. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Let me give you my last point as I close. There's one thing for this nation to say we believe in God, but it's another thing to live a godly life. Point number one, America's downfall lies in the complacency, indifference, apathy of its people. Point Point number three, I'm going to give you a Bible course in 101. The true interpretation about separation of church and state. That's been a big controversy, and people don't realize what the separation of church and state is. And I'm going to give it to you so you'll understand what it means, because it never meant that the church has to, the government can tell the church what to do, but the church ought to have some say-so in the government. Amendment number one said, Congress shall make no laws respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. We need to keep the government out of church, but the church is in the government. And we need to remember that, yes, a church should have rules and laws. Again, just like they have laws on the book, the church should be able to have laws that they stand for according to the word of God. I'm not going to get into amendment number two, the right to bear arms, because we done took that out of character, and we're going to have a wild, wild west where everybody have a gun. They said if the teachers had guns in Texas, they would be able to shoot. Let me tell you, we don't need teachers carrying guns. We don't need everybody to get a gun, because it will be just like the wild, wild west, and we don't need everybody shooting up everybody. Amen, somebody. We need everybody with a gun. No, we don't. We need to go back to trusting God and teaching principles. We have forgotten God. We've done all this stuff. We've taken credit for the peace in our nation. The only reason that you have peace is because God allowed us to defeat these enemies, to keep them from coming in. Our nation is affluent. We have multiplied and we have riches. America is one of the richest nations in the world. Don't take credit for it. The only reason, let me tell you, the only reason you're not starving like you used to see that starvation in Africa. You didn't see these children with these bloated bellies. The only reason that you are not starving is because God has blessed America by giving land and fruit and giving a rain so you have crops. And then the gross national product and the exports and the import, you are blessed. And I said last week, you need to be thankful, because there's a lot of food can get contaminated. But God has blessed America because he takes care of his people. Let me ask somebody. We've forgotten God. We become too self-sufficient, self-conceited. We become arrogant in our heart. Too proud to call on God. Too proud to give God thanks. We need to get back to loving God. We need to get back to honoring and respecting God. Let me leave you with a few reminders in the scripture as I get ready to close. Daniel said it like this. He said, the Most High rules in the kingdom of men and gives it to whoever he will. It's okay to vote, but let me help you out. Whoever get the office, God already allowed it. So let's not fuss and fight about the Democrats or the Republicans or the Democrats. Well, I didn't vote. I don't care who you voted for. Whoever you voted for, whoever wins, God allowed it. Amen, somebody. Psalm 73:25, David said, who am I in heaven but thee? And there is none upon earth that I can desire but thee. Proverbs 3:17 says, the Lord, his ways are pleasantness, happiness, and all his ways are peace. When you get to Deuteronomy 33:29, they say, happy art thou, Israel, who is likened to thee, O people, saved by the Lord. The Lord is their help. One nation under God. We're in God we trust. Let me tell you, we need to get back to God. Thou shalt not take the Lord's name in vain. I'm telling you, we got so many people using the Lord's name as a curse word. Let's get back to stop blaspheming the name of the Lord. Let's not take the Lord's name in vain. Let's not use any talk to download the Lord or the Trinity. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Not to speak malicious against the Holy Blessed Trinity. His eyes on the sparrow. You know, Matthew 10:29 says, if one of them fall to the ground without your father. Let me tell you, if God can feed the birds, he can take care of you. Let me tell you, God told him, he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. If God can feed, I've never seen a sparrow serve a sowing seed. I've never seen a sparrow having to worry about where his next meal will come from. So if God take care of the bird, he can take care of you.
Amen.
Then he said, look at the grass. God clothed the grass. He clothed the earth. If God can clothe this earth, he can take care of you. Stop worrying about where your clothes going to come from, where your food going to come from, where you going to live at. God takes care of the grass. God takes care of the bird. God will take care of you.
Amen.
The Bible says you're much more than the sparrow. Amen, somebody. The song goes, his eye Because it's eyes on the sparrow. I don't remember the words of the song, but we need to remember God take care of the sparrow. As I close, let me give you a couple of pledges that I made. You might want to add these pledges to me. I pledge my faith in Jesus Christ. I pledge my loyalty to God, the church, the Trinity, Jesus, the Father, and Holy Spirit. I pledge that I will live a Christian life and that I will pledge allegiance to the flag and the Christian flag and the Bible. I pledge that I will support my schools and I would vote that they would have an option to have the Bible back in school. I pledge in my duty to love and support this country with all its faults and all its, what they say, blemishes and all its warts. I still love America. I pledge to obey the law. I know what you're saying, preacher. What does obey the law mean? It means that if you see a red light, you stop. It means if you see a stop sign, you stop. I know what you're saying, preacher. Well, ain't nobody watching. Let me tell you, they got cameras out now when you break laws. So let me tell you, obey the law. I pledge to respect and do things, and I pledge to defend this country. When our military go to battle, they take a pledge when you're in the military. And your pledge is if the enemy comes against this country, you are to go and defend this country. I'm so glad I got people in my family, and I know people who have served well. Matter of fact, I'm going home next month to my niece. She served 23 years in the Army, in the Air Force, and she's retiring. And by the way, if you didn't know it, I just shared with you. I don't mean to bust up over, but she didn't go to college, but she got so good that they made her E7. And then she started training second lieutenants that came out of college. Then they promoted her to an E8. And then she had another chance to get hired. And she said, I'm graduating. I'm retired with a great salary. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Let me tell you, I pledge to support the military. I pledge to be a good citizen. I pledge to read my Bible every day. I pledge to say my prayer. I pledge to love my wife and children. I pledge to be a good citizen. I pledge all these things you can pledge to. But the first of all, you need to be born again. Amen?
I hope so.
If you're born again, you won't have any problems. You'll be like Daniel. When Daniel was a little teenager, Daniel said, I cannot eat of this king's meat, and I can't drink his wine, because I believe in the God of Jehovah. Or you'll be like Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego on our vacation Bible school. They say, I cannot bow to this Nebuchadnezzar statue, this golden image, because I serve a God who's able to deliver me out of your hands. Or you'll be like Daniel when they're going to throw him to the lion. Daniel, they caught him praying 3 times a day. They saw him, and they said, Daniel, he's going against the king. He's in there praying. And they said, we're going to tell the king to make a decree that anybody pray to anybody besides the king will be cast until the end of the line. Daniel said, well, I guess I'll just keep on praying. And Daniel prayed, and they throwed him in the lion's den. But you know what, Daniel? God delivered him. So let me tell you, we need to pledge and trust in God. All my help, all my strength, all my savings, all my finances come from the Lord. What you saying, preacher? Can you get counsel? Yeah, I can get counsel. My father, I'm praying for him and posture counsel. There's a lot of people in my family. But I'm telling you right now that I still serve a God who sits high and looks low. I still serve a God who's Jehovah Jireh, who can provide. I still serve a God who's Jehovah Nissi, Abana, who can, Rapha, who can heal. I serve a God who can do everything that I need. As I close it, I want to challenge you when you go tomorrow and you eat your barbecue, baked beans and your clothes off. Think about it. God, he's the one that made it possible. As I close Facebook, I always like to give an opportunity for those that are watching my Facebook to become a child of God. If you've never been a child of God, I want to give you an opportunity. The scripture says I need to cast a net. So the net goes something like this. You say, preacher, I understand what you're saying. I don't want to go to a devil's hell. I want to go to heaven when I die. So it's a simple prayer. It goes something like this. Dear Jesus, I believe that you came to earth. I believe that you died on the wicked cross. I believe that you was buried, and on the third day you rose from the dead. Lord, I don't want to go to hell when I die. I want to go to heaven. So, Lord, forgive me of my sin, Lord. Help me not to just talk the talk or walk the walk. Lord, come into my heart and save me, Lord. Write my name in the Lamb Book of Life. If you prayed that prayer, I want to tell you about the authority of the Word of God. God saved you. But don't stop there. Get into a Bible-believing church where you can grow in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So until next week, Facebook, look up.